Hello student, in this lesson let us discuss about the general introduction wherein we'll study the different types of modes of transportation. We'll see what are all the types, what are the advantages of each type, what are the disadvantages of each type, and we'll see which to choose when, and we'll see the common differences which are there between the different modes of transportation. So modes of transportation, nothing but it describes different ways in which the goods are transported. So it describes what? Different ways in which goods are transported. Now, these modes of transportation has been divided into 5 categories, and there is a 6th one which is a mixture of all these 5 categories. So to start writing, first one is your rail transport, the second one is the road transport, third one is the air transport, fourth one is the water transport, and the fifth one is the pipeline transport. And combining all this, we have one more type of transport, that is the multi-mode transport. Multi-mode, or we can call it as multi-modal. So wherein we have the combination of one or more types of transport in it. So now let us move ahead and start seeing what each type of transport is, what are the advantages and disadvantages of each type of transport. Okay, so the first one is the rail transport. Now, where is this suited? This is suited for heavy and large load over long land journeys. So what does that mean? So whenever you have heavy and big or large loads and you have to take them from one place to another via land, then we can go for what is called as rail transport. Now it has its own advantages and disadvantages. So let's see what are the advantages and disadvantages we have in the rail transport. Now the first advantage is the overall cost, which is low. So per unit weight, if you take the cost which will have to use for the rail transport is at the minimum. And the next advantage is it is safest of all the types of transports what we have. So we can say the point as the safest type of transport is the railway transport. Next advantage is what? Now it can be effectively linked to your multimodal system. So in the multimodal system, as I told, you have more than one mode of transport. So whenever we are using multimodal transport, railways can be effectively linked with the multimodal transport. So effective linked with multimodal type of transport. So these are the major advantages what we have in your railway transport. Now moving on to the disadvantage. So what happens in railways is the routes are fixed between terminals. So whatever rail routes are there, we have to follow the same rail routes. We will not have any new routes unless they are constructed and they are fixed. So the terminals, there are fixed terminals between your routes. That is one of the disadvantage. Right. Moving on to the next disadvantage. We cannot stop at intermediate points, or immediately if you want to stop, we cannot stop. So cannot stop at intermediate points. Okay, emergency exit is there. By pulling the chain you can do it, but at intermediate points, if you want to just generally stop, it is not possible. Okay, and one more major disadvantage of the rail transport is we don't have door-to-door service. Door-to-door service is not available here. Okay, why? Because if we want to travel via rail, we have to go to the railway station from our houses, and or from the place where we want to start, we have to go to the railway stations. Only then we will be able to catch up a rail. So these are the advantages and disadvantages of the rail transport. Moving on to the next one, which is the road transport. So one thing I want to mention here is rail transport will come under land transport. Okay. Similarly, your road transport will also come under land transport, wherein we are using the land for the transport. Now, road transport, this is the most common type of transport we have. So, in almost all places, we use the road transport. So, road transport can be done using various type of vehicles, two-wheelers, four-wheelers, three-wheelers, right, trucks, lorries, buses, n number of vehicle types are there through which we can do the road transport. Now, road transport also has its own advantages and disadvantages. So, let us see one by one what are the advantages and disadvantages. The main benefit or the very important benefit or advantage of road transport is the flexibility. So it is very flexible. Flexibility in the sense like we can leave at any time we want, we can travel in any speed we want, we can stop wherever we want, we can choose whichever route we want. So there is flexibility in almost all category in case of your road transport, unlike your rail. Say in rail, what will happen? Timings are fixed, routes are fixed, everything is fixed there. So we don't have any much flexibility. But here we have ample flexibility. And the next point, as I mentioned, travel speed. We can choose our own travel speed for doing the transport via road. Next, through same road, large amount of vehicles can travel. Okay, so what we can say is large number of carriers working in the same route means what? In the same road, any number of, I mean, it's limited to the capacity of the road, those many number of vehicles can move. Whereas in rail transport, what will happen? One track is fixed for one vehicle itself at a time. So, that is not possible there, but road has the advantage that we can incorporate large number of vehicles into one road. Then, it is also easy to monitor the location when you are going via the road transport. So easy to monitor location of goods or people who are traveling in the road transport. So these are some of the major advantages which we have in road transport. Moving on to the disadvantages. What are the disadvantages? Is for long distances it may not be suitable. Okay, so we have to go for short distance only. For long distances, what will happen? It will take lot of time, it will take lot of fuel. So all this will happen. So for shorter distance only, it is benefited. But for long distance, it is not benefited. That is one of the disadvantages. And the major disadvantage is the traffic or the congestion. So if there is traffic, there will be delay. Right. So what we can write this point as vulnerable. Vulnerable means it depends more majorly on congestion. Congestion is nothing but a traffic jam or neck-to-neck movement of the vehicles. Congestion and traffic delay. So it majorly depends upon congestion and traffic delay. This is one of the major disadvantages in your road transport. And next is the price majorly depends upon the fuel price. The amount of the amount which we have to spend on the road transport will majorly depend upon the fuel prices. So the fuel price keep on fluctuating, the cost which we concur for the road transport also keeps fluctuating. Understood. So these are some of the major advantages and disadvantages of the road transport. So this also come under land transport. Next, moving ahead, water transport. Now, what is water transport? Water transport is nothing but your transport through your ships, boats. Okay, all those things are water transport. So now, why water transport is important is majorly for big volumes and for international traffic. So for international export and import, water transport is very important. So let us write, this is important for big volumes or international traffic. So if you want to go overseas through air transport, it becomes very costly. So what we can do is we can then go for your water transport. Right, now water transport is nothing but transport majorly happening on the water surface. Again, this has its own advantages and disadvantages. To start writing one by one, so this is majorly suitable for what? Heavy and bulky goods. Heavy and bulky goods, this is suitable. Next, this is one of the cheaper means of transport when you compare the distance through which your goods are transported. Okay, so from one country to another country in a cheaper amount we can do the transport, unlike the air transport. So that is, these two are the major advantages. What is the disadvantage is monitoring where exactly the ship is very difficult. So monitoring the exact location will become difficult in case of water transport. So what we can write, we can write it as difficulty in monitoring exact locations. This is one of the disadvantage, and there is a limitation that all your ships has to be deported, or we have to reach the port itself. Okay, so the access is limited to ports when we want to do the loading and unloading. So limited to appropriate. So everywhere in the country you will not have ports, right? Only at few places you will have ports. So first of all, your goods has to go there, and then from the ports you can send it to other places. So the accessibility is limited to ports. That is one of the disadvantages and takes lot of time. So this transport takes time. So the means through which it will reach will take lot of time. So these are some of the disadvantages of water transport. So moving ahead, the next one is your air transport. Now majorly actually air transport is used for urgency, for perishable goods, and for goods of higher value. Well, so for all these things air transport is needed. Now how does the air transport happen? It happens through flights, choppers, all those things, right? Now this has advantages and disadvantages. So the major advantage and the one and only advantage is the speed of delivery. So 99% of the time air transport is chosen because of the speed through which the goods or persons can be delivered from or transported from one place to another. Now what are the disadvantages? First big disadvantage is it is very costly transport system. Out of all the transport system, this is the costliest transport system. Then what is the next disadvantage? Weight is limited. Weight is limited. We can take only certain weight in the flights. We cannot take more than that. And if you suppose want to export goods, what will happen? It will become very, very costly to export heavy goods in case of your air transport. Next, what is the next disadvantage? Again, here, like ports, we have to go to airports to get your access from one place to another. So, in the places where there is no airport, it becomes disadvantage and we cannot use the air transport. So, accessibility also is one of the issue or the disadvantage of air transport. Moving to the last type is the pipeline. Now, this is majorly used for the transport of oil and gases. And also, this major is oil and gases. One more way in which your pipelines are used is for water and sewage transport. So, for oil and gas, oil is nothing but your petroleum, your diesel, kerosene, all those things. So, there in the transport of these and certain type of gases, and also for water and sewage transport, we use the pipeline transport. Now, what are the advantages and disadvantages? Let us have a look on that. Coming to the advantages, so we can easily move large quantities for long distances. So move large quantities for long distances. So that is one of the advantage of pipeline transport. Next, this is the cheapest form of transport if you want to move any liquids. So, cheapest way in which your liquids can be transported, right? And what happens is it has flexibility in networks. Means what? Locally, what we can do, we can add pipes, we can remove pipes. It is very easily we can change the routes of it in local areas. So that is one of the advantages. Next, the disadvantages are it is being very slow means of transport. Next, inflexibility in certain cases. So inflexibility in certain cases. And it can carry only large quantities. Small quantities, if we want to carry through pipelines, it is very, very difficult. Only large quantity of certain type of fluids only can be carried using your pipeline transport. So, these are the five types of transports what we have. Now, there is one more type, the sixth type, wherein multimode. So, we use all the five types, air, inland, we have what? Rail and road, then water, then pipeline. So, we'll mix all of these and then do our transport so that it becomes efficient, all of these or one or two of these. So, basically more than one. Or all five. So, if in that combination we go for the transport, that type of transport is called multi-mode transport. Okay, so moving on to the next topic, this is what choice of mode. Now, when to choose which type of mode will depend upon so many factors. Okay. So, it depends upon what? Certain factors the major factors being what? The nature of the material to move. Nature of material to move. The second factor is the volume, or how much quantity has to be moved. Then the next one is distance through which the material or person has to be moved. So these are the major factors in which the choice of the mode of transport depends. Now let us see it in the form of a table so that it will be easy. So let's start with highway. Highway is nothing but what? Road transport. Next, rail is nothing but your railways. Next, water is nothing but through your ships. Next, air is nothing but through your aeroplanes. And next one is your multimodal, wherein we have the combination. So let us see one by one. If we want to choose based on speed, based on volume, based on security, based on cost, and lastly based on type of goods. So highway speed is what? High. Rail speed is what? Medium. Water speed is what? Very low. Air speed is what? Very high. And multimode, if you go, we can choose as high. So these are in which, suppose you want to go very fast, you choose air transport. Suppose there is no problem in the time or the low speed, if you want, you can go for this. So these are based on, speed is based on how fast your transport vehicle can move. That's your speed. Next, coming to volume. So highway, we can just use transport low volumes. In rail, we can transport high volumes. In water, we can transport very, very high volumes. In air, very low volumes we can transport. And in multimodal, we can transport medium level of things. Right, coming to security. So highway security is medium. So a lot of accidents, and suppose we stop somewhere, there might be robbery. So those types. In highway, again, we can call it as high. Water, we can take it as high. Air, we can take it as very high, because lot of security checks and all will go on. Then multimodal, again it is medium. Coming to cost, which has more cost, which has less cost. So highway, low cost. Rail, medium cost. See, highway, low cost, it depends. If you take for mass transportation, then it is low cost. If you individually go, then it varies. So basically, generally you can take it as low when compared to all of these. Then water, again low cost. Air, high cost. And then multimode, we can take it as medium cost. Now coming to the type of goods, what we can do, we can transport all types of goods here. Here in the rail, heavy and large loads. Heavy and large loads we can transport. Again here in water also, heavy and large loads. In air, as I told, urgent, perishable, and highly valuable. These all types of loads we can transport. In multimodal, again all type of loads can be transported. See, goods can be either material or man. Okay, so this is how you choose a particular type of mode. So based on five factors, I have explained 2, 3, 4, 5. So based on five factors, I have explained which type of transport will be more effective and which type of transport will be less effective. Now, next, let us do some comparison between the different types of modes of transport what we have. So, this is one of the most important topic and question might be appearing in the exam using this topic. Okay. So, it's nothing but the comparison between the railways and other modes of transport. Basically, between all the four modes of transport, here will not be dealing with pipeline transport. Okay. So, the table consists of serial number, point of comparison, railways, roadways, waterways and airways. So, there are totally 16 points which we have to discuss. So, in short, if you want to write, you can write the previous topic, that is the choice of mode. But comparison is very, very important, as I told you. So, let's get started. So, the first point of comparison is construction of the route. So, how you construct the route for different types of transport is the first point of discussion. So, in railways, what will happen? Tracks with rails on the land. You construct the track with rails on land. In roads, what you do? Pavement. We construct the pavement. Nothing but road. So, the technical name for road is nothing but pavement with shoulders on land. Okay. In waterways, what will happen? You will have trade routes which you have to follow. Okay. Trade routes over the water. Here it's on land, here it's on water. And in airways, what will happen? We have to follow the air routes in the space. So, this is the first point of comparison. The next point is traffic allowed. So, what type of traffic is allowed in what transport is what we'll see next. So, here what happens? Passenger trains and goods trains, right? We'll have different types of passenger trains and then only goods trains also we'll have. Right. So, these are the different types of vehicles what we have here in railways. In roadways, what will happen? We'll have buses, trucks, two-wheelers, then rickshaw, cars, and so on. So many types of traffics are allowed in the roadways. In waterways, what will happen? What we'll have? We'll have ships, boats, steamers, etc. Submarines, etc. will come in waterways. In airways, what will happen? We'll have aeroplanes, helicopters, rockets, etc. So, these are the types of traffic that are allowed in each type of mode of transport. So, the next third point is starting and destination point of traffic. So, starting and destination points of traffic. So, here what will happen? In railways, your starting and destination point are always fixed. So, you can't change the railway station, right? So, this always fixed. In roadways, it's not fixed. So, in waterways, it's generally fixed. Sometimes there is allowance that you can change it. So, that's why we call it as generally fixed. and in airways again always fixed. Okay, so fourth one is what? Right of entry of traffic. Right of entry of traffic means if you want to enter a railway track or a road or a waterway or an airway, what is the right you have? So here it is not free. You cannot freely take some own rail of yours. Whatever rail is fixed in the country, that you have to take. Here it's free to all category of traffic. So whatever type of traffic you want, you can take it here on the roadway. It is free for you. Here also, in waterway also, it is free for you. In airways, again, it is not free. You can take only particular aeroplane only. But here in vehicles of roadways and in ships and all, you can have free allowance for taking up your traffic. Here, the meaning of traffic is nothing but the type of vehicle. Okay, next, fifth point is the fuel required. So in railways, what is the fuel that we require? We require water, coal, diesel, and electricity. Right, in few type of trains we need coal and water, in few type we need diesel, in few type we need electricity. Next, coming to roadways, we have diesel, we have petrol, and in some we have gases, and in some we also have electric. We have some electric cars and stuff, so we can use electric also. Here in waterway again it's coal and diesel, and in airway it is what? Petrol and diesel. Right, the next sixth point is the operational cost. Not cost, control. So operational control. So how you control the operation of railway, roadway and waterway, airway is what we'll see here. So here we have signaling and interlocking. So based on signaling and interlocking, your railways will run. Okay. What is signaling and interlocking? We'll see on a later stage. Next, here in roadways, there is no special system. No system. So it depends on vehicle to vehicle and all. Here, it's based on wireless microwaves sent across the ships. And also there is a telex system wherein you transfer the signals and find out the location of the ship or the route in which your ship has to move. Okay, here in airways it's electronic systems which include radars. Here also to some extent we use the radars. Okay, next, seventh one is power required. So in railways we need the least power, in roadways we need average power, in waterways we need very high power, and in airways we need high power. Okay, next, eighth one is the load transportation capacity. Means what? How much of load you can take through each type of transport at a time is what is the thing which we have to study under the load transport capacity. So here the load transport capacity is high in railways, in roadways it is low, in waterways it is very high, we can take much of load in waterways, and here again in airways it is low. Okay, so moving on to the next point, this is the ninth point, initial cost. So in the railways, initial cost is very high. In roadways it is low, in waterway it is very high, because we have to construct port and all here, right? Here just the road construction, here again railway tracks laying and all, preparing the railways, goods, rails, everything will take cost. In airways it is low, so because we just have to build the airport. Right, the 10th point is cost of passengers and goods. Cost for passengers and goods. So how much we need to pay in each type of transport is what will come under cost of passengers and goods. So for railways it is low, for roadways it is low, for waterway it is high, and for airway it is very high. Next, 11th one is the comfort in the journey. So what, how much of comfort we'll have in each type of journey is what will come under this point. So here it is moderate type of comfort first we'll have. Here again it's moderate. Here less comfort because you'll have seasickness, and here we have more comfort. Next, the 12th point is the accidents which will happen in each type of transport. In railways it is less, in roadways it is more, in waterways it is less. It is less, but if the accident happens, it is more dangerous. Here, the accidents are more, but in it is less dangerous. But nowadays, because of the driving and all, what's happening, it is becoming more dangerous, and lives are being lost in this particular case. Right? Again, the accidents here are less. But if the accident happens, it is more dangerous. Right. Next, 13th point is employment opportunity. So how much employability each type of transport is giving will come under the employment opportunities. So here it is very good, because for example, if you take Indian Railways only, there are so many people who work under this. In roadways, an average amount of employees only work. In waterways, again a good amount of employees will work. And in airways, again a very good amount of employees will work. Next, moving on to the 14th, limitations. So what are the limitations here? We have, so this is suitable mainly for plain areas. Okay, here it is suitable for plain as well as hilly areas. Here this is suitable only for deep water transport. Right, and here it is suitable everywhere in the space. So suitability is a limitation. Only in those areas we can use a particular type of transport. Next, 15th point is future expansion. How we can further expand the mode of transport is what will come under this particular point. So railways, we can expand, so it is possible again with moderate cost. So you don't need huge amount of cost. With moderate cost, you can expand the railways. Here, this is also possible, but with very less cost, it is possible. Here, we need moderate cost. Here, next, waterways. This is also possible, but with very high cost. You have to invest very much in order to expand it. Again, airways also is the same. Here also it is possible, but again with very high cost. Moving on to the last point is the construction and maintenance. So here the cost for construction and maintenance is what? Moderate. Here it is low. Here it is heavy. And here it is very heavy. So hope you understood what is the different modes of transport we have, how to choose a particular type of transport, and what are the comparisons between different modes of transport. Thank you.